Li Cunxin, artist director of the Queensland Ballet, but perhaps better known as Miles' Last Dancer. Tonight's story is about two extraordinary Australian dancers, Stephen McRae and Alexander Campbell. They have been competing against each other ever since they were little boys. Like me, they both come from the most unlikely of backgrounds. Here's their story.
I grew up in a family that is obsessed with motorsport. I dreamt of being a top professional drag racer. My sister and I were always at the track.
We just sort of thought, well, Stephen will race when he's old enough. That was our life.
And then he came home one day after watching Kelly practice her dancing, and he said he wanted to go along to the dance studio and have a go at it.
I never thought he'd be a dancer, but he's proved us all wrong.
Good shot.
I would have loved to have become a professional cricketer.
One more, in the air, over there.
Cricket, for me, was a connection with my dad, I suppose.
Shot, good boy.
Any Aussie dad would love to have a cricketer for a son.
Woo! <Yeah.
laughs> He was very good at cricket, there's no doubt about that.
He was only a toddler, and suddenly he held onto the fridge handle, lifted his leg into a perfect attitude. We hadn't seen that coming. So Mum then took him to his first ballet lesson, and from then on, that was it.
How did this happen? How did two boys from Western Sydney end up principals of the Royal Ballet? You know, is there something in the water? What's happening?
Ballet is one of the great ballet companies in the world today.
To be a principal of the Royal Ballet, you're the creme de la creme. You're one of the best dancers in the world.
It's a special thing to be a male principal dancer. At the moment, we have 8 of them, and they do come from all corners of the world, but actually 2 of them are Australian. So that's quite rare, I have to say.
Was always Stephen and Alexander competing against each other? Who would have thought they would end up in Covent Garden dancing together instead of against each other?
I think it's inevitable that people would compare us. There was, you know, a rivalry of sorts, as much as there can be in ballet.
Now we're both principal dancers. There is an understanding between us and the way we work. I guess we can both really appreciate where we've come from. I grew up in the western suburbs of Sydney. My father's an auto electrician by trade, and my mum and dad ran their own business in Rudy Hill for, you know, over 20 years.
Dad started working when he was 14. Mum worked as well when we were young, and work ethic was a big thing in our family. You work hard and you get the results. Most weekends were spent at the racetrack with Dad drag racing. That was our life.
We balanced work, race car and dance. When he first started dancing, he was 7 years old.
I had just been to dance class and come home and almost bowled me over as I got in the door. Kel, show me what you just did. I want to learn. And I'm like, oh, mate, go away. Like, so annoying.
I said to Phil, oh, this won't last. He's too shy. He's not going to
do anything. You, yeah, won't even last a week.
The second I went into the studio and started dancing, I felt free. The teacher just said to me, jump as high as you can, spin as fast as you can.
When I did see what he could do, I was a bit shocked, I think. I thought, where did that come from?
I'm gone. I don't believe it.
I played cricket when I was really young.
Boy.
And soccer. We grew up, you know, doing a lot of sports.
Yeah. Now we're cooking.
Dad's a very sporty person. He was chairman of selectors for New South Wales.
How long since you faced the bowling machine?
A little while. You can set the speed.
Maybe we'll slow it up for you.
Maybe no bounces.
Cricket is so ingrained in our society. So the potential for Xander to go down that road was obviously pretty exciting for everyone in the family and Dad, considering his, you know, career.
Shot. And again.
You know, he could catch, he could bat, he could bowl, he could field.
Yeah, good catch. Yep.
He fitted into a category of people that could have pursued a career in that area had he chose to. But at the same time, of course, he was doing his dance.
When Alexander was about four, I think, his grandmother took him to a ballet concert. He sat and was quite fascinated by what was happening. And when he came home, he said, you know, oh, that was really great. That's what I want to do.
My idea of ballet wasn't little girls running around in skirts and stuff. It was, especially for a male, you know, you're jumping, you're turning. It's a whole body package. There weren't many boys in Sydney doing ballet at the time. Normally I was the only one in my class.
You know, I got as much pleasure out of seeing him develop in ballet as I did in cricket because it was totally unfamiliar to me. It was a new environment. I knew nothing about it.
I think Dad understood really well, you know, that it's probably in the genes.
Having two grandparents who were professional dancers, yeah, I suppose it is in my DNA.
You could see the talent was there. And he was prepared for the hard work. He always gave more than was necessary in any class.
Alexander's about 8 years old, and he suddenly said, I don't want to do ballet anymore. And then we realised that he was being bullied at school and, you know, a few guys had some stuff to say about, you know, being a fairy or that guys, you know, shouldn't be dancers and things like that.
I didn't feel that it was socially unacceptable, but I knew that it was unusual. I knew that it was okay for a male to be a ballet dancer. My grandfather was one. So it's obviously okay to be a ballet dancer.
You do hear whispers occasionally that boys don't dance. They say it's a bit girly or is he gay? And I say, well, it's not girly to dance. It's very strenuous. And if he was gay, what's the problem?
But I can remember my father discussing the fact that I danced quite early on at the racetrack with someone saying, yeah, he's really good, you should come and see him. And so when this particular day I was at my new high school and there was this little bit of a scene with some older kids saying, what's this, we hear you dance. And my father flashed in my vision and I just said to them, yeah, apparently I'm really good, you should come and watch me. And that was kind of the end of the conversation.
Stephen initially went to dancing 2 days a week, and then it got 4, 6, 7.
Encore was a plié, 3, 4. And show the extension after each frappe.
My teacher, Hilary Kaplan, she exposed me to this whole professional world that I honestly did not know existed.
Do the rond de jambe jeté on the danse. Just put it here.
She showed me videos of the Royal Ballet, and this light went on in my head, and I just said, I have to do this.
You could see his whole body tingling. You could see that steely determination. And yes, he wanted it and he was going to get it.
I hope one day to get into the Royal Ballet Company.
And three, jeté.
My main goal in life is to achieve principal status.
From here, you just step back. One and a, two and a, three and a, four.
She said, it's time, we're going to prepare you now to audition and send you over to London, the Royal Ballet School. But how is a family from western suburbs of Sydney going to afford sending their son to probably one of the most expensive schools in the world?
I thought we were just going to be scrubbing floors or something for the next few years. But whatever it took, he was going to that school.
There I am, a son of a drag racer, and Dad was the first one to say, great, go for it.
One of the first times I saw Stephen dance was at Warringah Stedford. He was able to do this step, chené, which is basically just spinning consecutively from one side of the stage to the other. And he did it like a top, he just... I remember watching thinking, I've never seen anyone do that step like that before. Even now, I still haven't been able to work out how he does it. From Sydney, you know, not far apart geographically and in age, going for the same thing.
Alexander and Stephen were tag teaming and competing in the same things, and Alexander won some, Stephen won some.
2002, the Jeanne International Ballet Competition came to Sydney.
Putting two boys in the same room, both being incredibly competitive and ambitious, was only going to be just like a positive result. So they were always going to be jumping higher or turning faster. And I think, yes, that encouraged them to up the level.
Both Alexander and Stephen were in the finals of the Jeanne, and I was one of the judges. And on that night, there was definitely one obvious winner.
And the gold medal goes to Stephen McRae.
The gold medal itself didn't provide me with masses of financial assistance to get me to London, but it most certainly opened the door.
I saw things that I was impressed by, and I thought, well, yeah, that's what I have to do, and that's what I'll work towards.
Numéro 122, Stephen McRae.
The next competition was the Prix de Lausanne, 2003.
I saw them both at the same time at the Prix de Lausanne competition. I was there as a judge.
And the prize is a scholarship to the best schools in the world.
Stephen got up and, of course, did one of his now famous tap solos, but at the time we'd seen nothing like it.
Numéro 117, Alexander Campbell.
I remember Alexander. I remember seeing a very natural dancer, lightly assured.
There was going to clearly only be one winner, which is always a difficult thing.
Il s'agit de Monsieur Stephen McRae.
I was announced as the winner that year. So I was given first choice of where I wanted to go. The final was on a Sunday, and Monday morning I was in London. The move was far more disruptive than I possibly could ever have imagined. It was so abrupt.
The day I had to leave him was a horrible day. The bus came to pick me up at the hotel to go to the airport, and he was there with me. Both of us were crying. I left Stephen on the footpath in London when he was 17. That's the day I left my boy, and now he's a man.
I was beyond homesick. It was a moment of absolute joy and celebration. Yet I had this sadness that felt like it was destroying me.
Wow.
We're in the same class at the Royal Ballet School. I actually remember sitting at the back of the studio and he just sat in the corner with tears in his eyes, and I just thought, God, what do I say to this guy? You know, I kind of shuffled over and I think I said something along the lines of, I do understand how you feel. The fact that he actually was able to stay in London told me something about him instantly, that this guy means business.
I obviously wanted it. I wanted it more than anything. And that makes me sound a bit of a monster, because I had to want it more than my family. And that's something still to this day I find a little bit difficult to live with, because I chose my career over my family.
Stephen won the top scholarship, but Stephen and I had both been accepted into the Royal Ballet School. Stephen, being a year older, went straight into second year, and I went into first year. There were 3 years of training. When we got to London, thankfully Mum was there and found a place for us to live together. I mean, we had rooms on either side of the corridor in Hampstead. It was nice, you know, to know someone who was in exactly the same position. We were certainly friends at that time.
London's a big place for a 16-year-old boy. Unfamiliar environment. You know, just the family dislocation was the thing that upset me.
Well, it was lonely. Being removed from your family.
That was our opening night at Sadler's Wells.
Well, I was able to tell him a few things that might happen.
Things haven't changed terribly much.
Not changed there.
I think it helped him a lot.
Swan Lake. Oh, you're a swan.
Yes.
Yeah.
There are times you're very sad and you weep into your pillow, but you've just got to get up the next morning and get to class and carry on.
When you go to the Royal Ballet Schools, there's absolutely no guarantees that you're going to get a job in any company, but especially the Royal Ballet, because it's a big pool of people and a small opportunity of jobs. Stephen McRae did. He graduated straight out of the Royal Ballet School and joined the Royal Ballet Company. And Alexander, when he graduated, joined the Birmingham Royal Ballet.
For the 6 years that I was in Birmingham Royal Ballet, there was absolutely no direct competition, I suppose, between us. So he had his career and I had mine.
Alexander's ambitious, but yeah, he's had his setbacks.
Alexander was already at Birmingham when it was established that he had this hearing loss.
I need hearing aids. I don't need hearing aids. I can hear. But actually, in a lot of situations, I struggle.
I didn't realise that it was actually that significant of an issue for him. There are certain instruments that he can't hear in the orchestra.
One of the hearing tests I had showed that I had probably 40% below average hearing.
He, I think, was born this way, so he didn't know the difference. We thought it was selective hearing.
Looking back, I realised I actually did have to teach myself to lip read, because that's how I work out what people are saying. I hear sounds, but I can't actually work out what that sound is if I can't see, you know, someone's face moving.
He's told me stories about waiting in the wings at the Royal to come on and get his cue and not being able to hear it. He'd have to have other dancers literally tap him or push him forward to get on stage.
Thanks, you too.
He's a very, very innately musical dancer.
Just try and keep a bit playful, especially with the last bit. head generally is better.
Maybe having worked through this lack of hearing has made him really much more aware than maybe most people are of music and dancing with the music and with his body using, interpreting the music. So it's really interesting. Stephen's had an extraordinary rise within the company, really.
I got promoted each year, climbing the ranks, doing roles that I'd obviously dreamt of. But then my body just stopped and said, no, this is not happening. I tore my Achilles. Some surgeons, they said, you'll never dance again. You'll have a limp for the rest of your life. Of course, I was not going to accept that. I was off stage a year. Yes, I had to learn how to walk again, but I then danced again.
It had been a really hard uphill climb. The mental battle and the mental strain that he had been under was huge. For Stephen to become a principal dancer was absolutely imperative. It wasn't an option for him to fail.
That was his goal, and he was principal at 23.
Given the injury that Stephen had, to get back so quickly and to become one of the youngest principal dancers of the Royal Ballet was quite extraordinary.
The day I was promoted to principal really was the beginning of hard work. It wasn't the climb to get there, it was, OK, you've got there, now stay there.
He'll just send a random message and he's like, oh, hey, guys, I've just been asked to dance for the Queen for lunch today at Buckingham Palace. And I'm just reading it like, oh, say hi to her for me. Have a cup of tea for me.
To be a principal dancer at the Royal Ballet means a great deal. I felt like I wanted to have a crack. So I joined the Royal Ballet in 2011. I joined as a soloist, and Stephen was principal by that time.
Alexander has beautiful line. He has very good feet. You don't hear him landing. I knew he would go to the top. I knew.
Finally, in 2016, it was a really exciting day for Alexander when he was promoted to principal.
I think I got through to Dad first. He said, oh, how'd the meeting go? I said, yeah, good. I just got promoted. Bullshit.
I was quite emotional about that, yeah. It was a great moment. Great moment for him, great moment for the family.
It's wonderful having Alex in that similar position. It's quite nice to have a fellow Aussie close by.
They've got very separate careers within the company, but they work very well and very respectful of each other. You can have more than one best dancer, and I think that's what we have with those two guys.
It's strange, because we're in the same company. We often do the same roles, but we rehearse at completely different times. In a professional environment, we actually don't come across each other that often. It's not easy in a competitive environment to maintain friendships in a sort of normal way. So, I wouldn't say we're particularly close now, but we get...
There's incredible competitiveness for the roles and the work. One day the casting will go up and it's got your name on it, and another day it'll go up and it's got someone else's name on it. And it happens, it's what we do, it's our life.
The life of a professional dancer can be a very lonely world. It can be an incredibly selfish world. We look at ourselves in the mirror all day, perfect lines and clean up things and to make ourselves better and better and better. So it's no wonder that there is an element of selfishness involved.
What is that?
That one's a Lamborghini.
That's not a Lamborghini, it's a car.
But you still need to be a human being. And thankfully, my wife has really, really helped that happen.
How are you doing with your lunch, Audrey?
A little bit slow.
And now that we have children, you can't be selfish when you have children. The children are everything.
I don't have a glamorous lifestyle outside of work. Being physically demanding as a job, I often just want to get back, put my feet up. Don't have a partner. It's difficult maybe to find people who are willing to, you know, be with someone who is tied to work in such a way.
His girlfriends have been wonderful to date. So I'm sure that, you know, he will find someone to share this life with.
Recently toured to Brisbane.
Belle and Beast were on stage when all of a sudden she lost a shoe, just like Cinderella.
It was really exciting to come back as one of two Australian principals.
It always is incredibly moving and emotional and joyful to take the moment to say, wow, that's my boy, and you've made it.
It's so good when he comes home. It's like going back to normal. It's like the missing piece of the puzzle has arrived.
It occurs to me sometimes that I don't know him really as an adult. There is an element of sadness, but we concentrate on the joy.
Are you wearing it like a hat? Yes.
It's hard because you've missed out on a big part of his growing up and family life. We've missed a lot of his and he's missed a lot of ours. I think as a mum, any mum would say that that's the hardest part.
My family are all in the audience tonight, which is really special for me. Obviously, I live on the other side of the world now, and they don't really get to see me perform at all.
I'll probably start crying, to be honest.
Sorry.
It's okay.
I just get so emotional for him, you know, but we're just so proud of him, and we can't wait. When Stephen performs, it's just like going back to when he was 7 years old for the first time for me. Even though I can do it, my stomach's doing backflips. I'm as nervous as anything.
I think my family sacrificed a lot, probably too much, in order for me to do what I did.
Looking back, I don't think I could do it all again.
Oh, my gosh, amazing.
But, I mean, who knows? For your children, you do anything, don't you?
Well done. Thank you. Well done.